honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air number 126 on money, family, wives, mobile phones, and boredom. And you are indeed welcome here in this young green Danish forest. Welcome.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air. But first, the normal, daily, early Buddhist contemplation. The Buddha's speech on friendliness. What should the clever one advantageously do to attain this state called peace? Is this? He should be intelligent, straight, honest, humble, gentle, and never proud, contented and easy to support, not busy, careful, and silenced, in abilities and senses, cautious and modest, neither flattering families nor be demanding, not doing even a minor trifle that other wise men might criticize. Then he should think, may all beings be joyous and safe. Let every creature's mind rejoice. Whatever breathing beings there are, no matter whether feeble or firm, with none excepted, whether long, tall, big, medium, short or small, whether seen or unseen, visible or not, whether living far away or near here, whether existing or just about to come into being, let every living being's mind be exultantly jubilant. Let no one ever kill or another being undo, nor ever harm anyone anywhere at all. Let no one wish even a minor bad for another, neither from provocation nor from revenge. Thus, as a mother with her own life might guard her only baby child, thus should he maintain a mentality of infinite friendliness for every living being, in gentle sympathy for this entire universe, unlimited, endless, and waste. As above, so below, and all around, unimpeded, without any hatred, purged of all enmity, whether standing, walking, seated, or lying down, while slumbering, he should always maintain such awareness of gentle and benevolent kindness. This very mentality is the divine dwelling here, they say. He that do not traffic with many speculative views, perfected in seeing what is right and wrong, purged of lust for sense pleasures, he will surely not come back here to any womb. And the canonical source for this Buddhist speech on friendliness is the minor readings and the illustrator, the Kudaka Bhatta. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 126, recorded in the Værhøj Forest on the Western Zealand in Denmark, a windy, chilly day in May 2019. I recorded today because they have the weather forecast says that it's gonna be frost and snow here in May, so better get it done today. There are three questions as usual, but first the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha indeed. The first question goes like this, question 380. What is the early Buddhist take on money, wife, rebirth, and cheating? Four questions, actually. What is the Buddhist take on money? Yeah, the Buddhist take is that this is a necessary evil, you can say. It's not, it has nothing in itself to do with evil, but it's the things that are connected with it that is can be disadvantageous, at least, or detrimental, akusala. So is it detrimental or is there any man bad in being rich? No, not if the money is earned in an honest way, that you take the right price for the right service or thing, and they are earned by your own, by the sweat of your own brow, and not by utilizing other people or by any dishonest means, like theft or fraud. So if you earn them by yourself in an honest way, then this is basically okay. What does it enable you? It enables you to, first of all, give away, and we say typically 20% in Buddhist, so 20% to others, that is to say your family, those who are worthy of it, those who need it. 20% you invest in your own business, 20% you use for your daily needs, 20% you invest in your house and in your household, your own family, and then the 20% you put in the bank for better times. So this is kind of like Buddhist economy. So you can say, but hoarding them up in it for their own sake, that is where it becomes disadvantageous. There's a story about a young monk that he's become an anagami. And then he comes from a very rich family, and he also had a lot of beautiful wives. And so he's invited home to his family, and he asks for permission from the Buddha to go. And since he's an anagami, then he has no sense desire left, no kamachanda left, kamaraga. So the Buddha says, you can go, you're ready to go back to your home. And there first, his former wives, he has several of them, they dress up in their most beautiful clothes, and then they present themselves in for him, and then he says, ah, sisters. And then they know just by this that he's calling them sisters. Then they are kind of like excited or agitated by that and feel sadness because he's apparently not tempted by their physical beauty. Then his mother and father stack up all the gold on a big heap on the floor in front of him, and all the family gold they take out of the treasuries. And then he says to them, mother and father, you can go and dump this in the river because it will cause you a lot of sorrow. And then he asks if there's any food to be given in this house to the monks. And then his father and mother serve him food, and then he goes back to he speaks some dana, some dhamma, and then he goes back to the monastery. So it just demonstrates that he could not be tempted by physical beauty, nor could he be tempted by exorbitant richness. So they could not get him out of the robe and back into the family business. And this is just shows the detrimental side of it. Let's say you have a lot of money or a lot of richness,
and a lot of material possessions, then it's very difficult to go forth. It's very difficult to concentrate on the path. Because you have this, all this, you have to maintain this and keep track of it. So it tends to lead away from Nibbana and towards Samsara. If Nibbana is this way, out in the open, towards lasting happiness, then money will and material possessions in general will drag one back into Samsara, because one becomes disengaged or engaged and involved with this money business. Whether it's money in the bank, or it's investments, or it's housing, or whatever it is, then it will keep one in Samsara. So it's a shackle on your feet if you cling to them. And it's very difficult not to cling to money, because money basically can be exchanged into whatever kind of pleasure, whatever kind of desired object that you want. One good way of looking at it is to say, can this money, can this save me from birth, aging, sickness and death? No. They cannot. Can they save me from suffering? No, they cannot. Rich people, they also get old. They also get cancer. They also lose their family members. They also feel sorrow. They also become old and decrepit. So they cannot. They cannot. It looks like since you can buy everything, then you can also buy happiness. No, you cannot buy happiness. You cannot buy love. You cannot buy understanding. You cannot buy nirvana. You cannot buy freedom from suffering. You cannot buy freedom from sickness, aging, and death. You cannot buy for money. Not possible. So, on the practical level, the Buddhists would say, it's something that you can utilize. You can utilize also to promoting the path. This camera is bought with some money that has been given to a foundation that has supports me, and therefore this Dhamma can be spread through this camera, which is fairly expensive, actually. So they can be utilized in a good way, and that's the way to look at it, to utilize it in a good way, to something that has lasting value. And this is, Dhamma is one example of them. You can also utilize them in other, in reasonable ways, but one can also slander them away. Another danger is, of course, one keep hoarding them up and place investments and so on, and then die very rich, but not having done much good. And this then will be inflicted in one's future rebirth. So the ideal case is that one's bank account and all one's material possessions, they are given away before one attains death. So they are converted, one's material possessions could go into zero, and then one's karmic bank account should go be maximized by this giving them away or investing them in something that has benefit for other beings at oneself. This is the ideal case. This should happen not at the moment of death, but then in front of death, some months or years before. It doesn't count if one says one doesn't give them away, but one's family gets them, because this is basically the government or the law that they distribute them. That's not giving it away. So one should give it away actively, deliberately, before death. Making as many Americans do nowadays, very rich Americans, they say they give a pledge to, at the moment of death, give half their richness away, or more than that, 80%. Bill Gates have done that, for example. So this means that others will benefit from it, not only his own family members. And this is very, very advantageous. I would though say, it will be even better to give them away before death and participate in the giving oneself. So this is the ideal case. Where to best place them? There, where one feels joy of giving. Where one feels joy of giving. Where one is needed most. And where those who get it are worthy of it. And those who get it, they invested in getting, for example, the Dhamma out. But investing in a school will also do good, or in a hospital, something like that. Something that has general benefit for others. The highest benefit, I still have to say, is connected with the Dhamma. Why so? Because if one give it, for example, to a forest monk or to make a forest monastery, then one actually gives it so that the way to deathlessness, to Nibbana, can be given to somebody else. And the way to deathlessness is the highest you can give away, because this cannot be bought by money, and everybody wishes it. basically because it's the end of suffering. So that's the highest purpose you can place your investment in. It's not Tesla or Google. It's a Dhamma that is the highest purpose, and it's the best investment seen in the long run. Again, back to, there's nothing odious or bad or detrimental in being very rich if one has earned one's money in an honest way. And even if one have inherited. If one has cheated or stolen or committed fraud and thereby get this on unrighteous means, then there's a problem. Basically, this is counter theft then. Next question. How does early Buddhism look at wife? We can also say husbands and children and so on. Yes, again, it's the same thing. It's something that can benefit you on the path, but it can also be an obstruction. If one is very much in love with one's wife, then one cannot go forth and one cannot approach Nirvana unless she or he, one's spouse also is a Buddhist. And it's eventually something that will, if one is very much used to their company and association with them, then will keep one back in samsara. One will come back to samsara and look for the same wife, the same children also in many cases. So it's something that keeps one stuck in samsara and thereby abrogates the path to nirvana. That said, it can also, on the other hand, be used to be a companion that travels along towards nirvana. By being a family that decides or is traditionally Buddhist and then supports good Buddhist purposes on the long run. So there it can be, it can be used both ways, and it depends upon these circumstances. Usually it is so, there's many cases in the Buddhist text about only one spouse is Buddhist, that the other one is not Buddhist. And then this places ambiguity of whether the being together with the spouse is advantageous or disadvantageous, kusala or akusala, wholesome or unwholesome, on the long run. So depends upon the circumstances. However, having a spouse, having a partner, having association to other beings, one should know that eventually one will have to depart. So as the Buddha say, all meetings ends in departure. So it ends in separation. And so if one is falling in love down here, I have affection here, then when it separates, then one feels sorrow. So this engagement, involvement in other beings, either in the romantic way or in a habitual social way, this spells for future sorrow, because one will tend to be separated anyway, whether one likes it or not. If not before, then at death. What is the Buddhist take on rebirth? Yeah, rebirth is an essential doctrine and fact that one has to know. And this one has to kind of like take into consideration also when living left life. Starting to consider rebirth at the moment of death is too late. So one has to incorporate it in this life. And so one is living a rebirth now. And one is using up karma one has planted in the former times. So one should replenish this karma, fill up the karma, so one can have a good rebirth in the next life to approach the Nibbana and approach the Dhamma even more. So rebirth is something that one should consider every day. Consider every day, like also considering death. Then say, where may I go? Where did I come from? Where am I now? It's not something that one needs to speculate a lot about, but it's something that just can kind of like roll over the mind. Roll over into the mind that one is living now in this world. There's another world. One has come from other worlds also. One has been here many times before. As the Buddha said to his monks, you see this mountain over there? Yes, Venerable Sir, they say. Ah, you have made a mountain of bones that is bigger than this mountain, just in this universal cycle, in this aeon, in this kalpa. What is it that you want? You want to make a mountain of bones more? Is that happiness? one can ask oneself, to make mountains of bones, fill up the cemeteries? No, absolutely not. A Brahmin came and asked the Buddha that he wants him to point out a place on Earth, planet Earth, where nobody has been buried ever. And then the Buddha, he scanned around with his all-seeing eye, which can also scan back and forth in time. And then he said, I cannot find any place where there's not been digged down people many times. So there's no place where there's not been digged down people. So this hole is one big burial ground. This is another factor of looking at this birth, aging, sickness and death, this samsara, this cycle, this vata, this round of kilesas, of mental defilement, not of a me, of an ego, of an I that goes around and round and round and round and round, again and again and again. Being partially blinded, not knowing the Four Noble Truths, not seeing one's former rebirth and not seeing one's next rebirth. One keep going on, thinking is new every time, because of forgetfulness and lack of mindfulness. This should not be done. And therefore one should know, rebirth is something, is around, is a troublesome thing, because one will keep coming back to this aging, sickness and death. This is what rebirth is about, aging, sickness and death, and not much else. Yes, while you're intoxicated with youth, you use all kinds of stuff and have all kinds of fun and so on. Yes, there is some pleasure to be found there, I don't deny, but nevertheless, the story still ends the same way. It's like a spy fly in a bottle. There's an opening up in the top, but it cannot find out. This Nibbana, only the Dhamma can lead you out of this bottle of samsara. And if you look, it stays down in the bottle because there's a little bit of sugar water, sweet things, sweet sensations, something sweet that you can see, hear, smell, taste, touch, and think. That's down on the bottom of samsara. So it keeps to the bottom. And if one looks a little bit next day on the same bottle, then the spy fly lies with the legs upwards and is mixed into this Coca-Cola or whatever it is on the bottom of the bottle. So it has been killed by the sweetness, sticky sweetness itself, the sweetness of life, that there is these tantalizing forests. There's this tantalizing sex, drugs and rock and roll that one keeps clutching onto and think, this can provide me everlasting happiness. But this is not the case. On the contrary, one keeps buzzing around in samsara like a fly in a spy fly in a bottle. What is the Buddhist take on cheating? yes. Cheating should not be done, of course not. This is kamesu michachara, sexual abuse. So cheating will say one have sex with somebody else's partner, or one have a partner oneself and then one have promised oneself to this partner, whether in a marriage or marriage-like state, and then one have sex with somebody else. And then one knows this partner, the other's partner's partner will become very sorrowful, and oneself becomes very sorrowful, and one's own partner will also become very sorrowful. Still one does it because there's this temptation of sexual stimulation and a short moment of pleasure that usually doesn't last more than half an hour. And then one can have regrets and remorse and regrets for months and for years over these singular events. So this is something that one should just say, no, this is a wrong way. It's a tempting way, but it's also a wrong way. And it costs more than you gain. Yes, there's some small pleasure, this half an hour pleasure to be gained, but then compared to these months or years of remorse and regret towards your own partner and also towards having betrayed somebody else's, this clearly outweighs this small pleasure gained. So this one should abrogate. One way of abrogating is looking, I say, okay, am I really slave of something that I can hear, see, taste and touch, and this mental state of orgasm? Is I really so much slave of it that I cannot say no to it and thereby come around this sharp corner of long-lasting sorrow? that also can be so sorrowful that it determines the destination if it's remembered at the moment of death. Can I really not that this can bring me to hell? It can bring to animal rebirth, to the fearful states, apaya. This surely this sexual, sensual abuse can do me. So seeing this, one should stay away from it. Stay away from it. One story I heard was a couple, young couple, that engaged in these swinger clubs, where this is more or less agreed where one should swap partners and so on. And then the husband of this particular wife, it was a married couple, he fell in love with one from the swinger club. And he was working together with his wife, they'd done for many years, in a hair shop that was cutting hairs. And then he took together with his lover into the hair shop, so the wife has to go together with the new lover from the swinger club. And eventually she felt so much, she could not get out of it, because economically she was dependent upon the husband and the hair shop. So she had to stand by and look at these two new lovers that was got because of a mutual agreement that she did deliberately together with her husband to get this new kinky sex. She eventually killed herself because of this sorrow, because she had to be in this hair shop every day together with her rival, a younger lady. And this made her felt very big sorrow. So you can say it started very sweet. It started very sweet as something that was very tantalizing, but it ended up with being a humongous amount of sadness and eventually a suicide. So this one can see and then immediately, it's the wrong path, it's the wrong path. And I think everybody knows it in advance, because everybody has been down this lane before tons of times in samsara. And one knows it. If one listens to one's own intuition and say, is this right or wrong? Then one can immediately feel it's wrong. But one is still tempted by the pleasure. And therefore, this pleasure has two sides. It can be very sweet, yes, but it can also lead one into evil states, because one is addicted to it and cannot say no. One has no control, self-control, over what this body and mind does when it's faced with high pleasure, new pleasure, tantalizing pleasure. This is something that one should know. This is something that one should know. Everything has a price, and the price for any kind of pleasure is higher than one should think because of this addiction. But in the case of where one hurts others, as in cheating, both hurts one's own partner and another's partner, then it's much higher than one immediately should think. And it's not worth the pleasure that you get. Far from it. It's not even one thousandth or one millionth of it. So it's dangerous. Dangerous. Next question, 381. Is a bhikkhu or bhikkhuni allowed to use books, smartphones in a temple or community? Yeah, books, definitely so. Because Dhamma books is what we go, there's 56 books in the Tipitaka, in the Buddhist Bible, so to speak, so it's 2 meter of text. So these are, of course, not only allowed, but prescribed to use, which is the text of the Buddha. As you can see here, there's the Digha Nikaya, the Majjhima Nikaya, the Samyutta Nikaya, and the Anguttara Nikaya, and a lot of other texts, counting up to something like 8,000 pages, 10,000 pages, depending on the edition. So it's a humongous amount of text that one should read. I recommend reading the 5 Nikayas of the Sutta Pitaka that I just mentioned, the long collection, Digha Nikaya, the middle collection, Majjhima Nikaya, the numerical collection, the Anguttara Nikaya, and the collected Samyutta Nikaya, texts of the Buddha, and then the Kudaka Nikaya, the collection of small texts also, which is actually fairly many. Among them, the Jatakas, the birth stories, which is 3 volumes of the former birth of the Buddha, where we have now together 547 left. But also various poems and all kinds of texts. Read this before the end of one's life. That's a good thing. So books definitely allowed. What about phones and computers? The computers and phones, there's not any laws that prohibit it. or spoke about it, because the Buddha, of course, wasn't present at the Buddhist time, so he didn't place any laws about it. But it's something that can be used in two ways, also like money and association with other beings can be used in an advantageous way, with the purpose of leading others to Dhamma and thereby showing them the Noble Eightfold Way. And this, for example, this camera and the laptop I used to edit this video on, and this is used for this purpose. When it's used for this purpose, then it's allowable. If it's used to see entertainment film on, or news, or whatever, that has nothing to do with the Dhamma, then it's disadvantageous. And then we will say it's not allowable. But it's, strictly speaking, neither phones nor computers are either allowed or prohibited in the by the Buddha, because there was no, he didn't put any laws about it, because they were not present at his time, of course. But again, it depends upon how you use it. If you use it for the right purpose, then I would say it's allowable by proxy, because they are something that promotes the Dhamma, promotes the setting free, promotes the lasting happiness, promotes the way to Nirvana, not only for oneself, but for many other beings. It also goes if you have to call somebody, a layperson, to come with Dana tomorrow, or you should call somebody to get something arranged with papers with the government, or invite somebody or something. There's a lot of practical purpose, and thereby phones are very practical. But they can also be obsessive if you have to check your Facebook account, a messenger all the time, and it says bling, 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 bling every time you get a message. Huh? This is also the case. So again, they have two sides, something that is advantageous, kusala, or wholesome, something that is akusala, detrimental, or unwholesome. And it's up to you to be disciplined enough in each moment, and this is by no means easy, to use them in the right way, to use them to set free, to use them to propagate the Dhamma, and not in an unwise fashion. So, when communicating with spiritual friends, as we do in this case, then I would say that computers and internet and cameras and software and so on is not only allowable, it is advantageous. It is to be recommended, because it obviously is used in a purpose that is noble and it sets beings free. So definitely good. The last question, how to deal with intense boredom, is question 382. How to deal with intense boredom, which is disgust combined with mental suffocation? Yes, boredom actually is equanimity, upekka, that one is not aware of. So there's neither gladness nor sadness. There's neither pleasure nor pain. It's a neutral feeling. But if not aware of it, then it falls into boredom. However, if there is mindfulness, awareness, sati, regarding this neutral state of neither sadness nor gladness, neither pain nor pleasure, then it is felt as peace. So one can convert boredom to peace if one becomes aware of it. When it's felt as boredom, then I think first of all, not aware of this neutral feeling, and secondly, there's craving, usually sensual craving. Craving to see something new, to hear something new, to taste something new, and thereby get this sense stimulation, to touch something new or have a new mental state. Craving for entertainment, for example, which becomes more and more and more and more explosive in the entertainment world, because everybody is doped and saturated with drama that is to the extreme degree, huh? If you think about, for example, Hollywood and all these hero movies, how much the action drama has to be action, has to be explosions, how much the porn industry has to be porn, has to be so explosive in order to stimulate people still. And same thing also with food and with hotels all kinds of stuff that it has reached extreme levels. Extreme levels. It just shows this catch 22 of sense stimulation, that it's like a pit that you put down something, you try to satisfy this sense craving by giving some object that the sense craving wants, something to see, for example, by seeing a film or a piece of art or a porn or whatever. But the more you feed it, the deeper the hole becomes. So it's like when you put something down in this hole, by a paradoxical way, because of adaptation, the hole becomes deeper and deeper. Doesn't become filled up. So you never reach a point where they're fully satisfied. Never, never, ever. On the contrary, the more you fill it in, the more you feed the mind this sense stimulation, the more it becomes used to and thereby adapts to this, which then becomes boredom. So you have to then get a new sexual object or a new film or a new kind of food and have to have it in a larger amount or more refined to get the same level of satisfaction. But still, if you get the same level of satisfaction or even higher satisfaction, still it will fade off. Then you have to feed the animal again and again and again and again. This is running in circles again. And while doing this, plucking these flowers, many are around me here, white flowers of sense pleasure, then the Buddha say, I want it swept over by this dukkha that comes from behind, like a wave. One is swept over by birth, aging, sickness, and death. Swept over. Like the flood, a sleeping village. Huh? The village sleeps, but then suddenly comes the big tsunami waves. And then you never find the village again because it's basically drowned in mud. It's gone. It's history. So that's the case. When urging for this sensuous pleasure, then one can use a good thing, which is Buddha's notice about right speech. And he said there's 10 advantageous objects, and then there's something that is disadvantageous objects of speech, and thereby also thought, thereby also activity. The 10 advantageous subjects of speech, and thereby also thought, is the modesty of having few wants, the bliss of contentment, the joy of seclusion, being secluded from one's defilement, being physically secluded from engagement, involvement in samsara, the ease of disentanglement, the energy of enthusiasm, the advantage of morality, of purity, of moral behavior, the calm of concentration, meditative concentration, the insight of understanding, the freedom of release, and the direct knowledge and vision of release. So this is fairly high points of Dhamma that one can return to again and again and again and again. And this is something completely else, something completely otherwise. It's something else than sex, drugs, and rock and roll that makes the pit even deeper. Is something else. It's something that leads towards Nibbana. It leads towards absolute peace, complete freedom, and the highest happiness. Leading towards that, one cuts out this samsaric buzzing around. One cuts it out. The disadvantageous subjects or bestial conversation and thinking is conversation about kings, robbers, ministers, states, armies, alarms, battles, food and drink, clothing, furniture, garlands, sins, that is cosmetics, relatives, vehicles, cars, villages, towns, cities, the countryside, women and heroes, the gossip of the street and the will, the tales of the dead, the tales of diversity, the creation of the world and of the sea, and whether things exist or not. So all kinds of hypothetical, philosophical subjects one can endlessly think about. This is basically going in circles. One can keep coming back to these advantageous things. Here in Denmark, and I think everywhere else also, we have some magazines which are full of this stuff. There's some for ladies and some for men, some for young and some for a little older. And they are full of all kinds of stuff regarding this issue. Because of the advertisement industry is pumping out and knocking your door in an unprecedented way. So somebody says that we are bombarded with 5 times more information than we were 100 years ago. And it's very, very difficult to sort out what is important and what is not important. That's where the Dhamma comes in. Cut out everything else, basically. Then go back to nature and the Dhamma. That's enough. More than enough to be happy. More than enough to be free. More than enough to find back to the right path, the Noble Eightfold Way. And what is Noble Eightfold Way? Yeah, the Noble Eightfold Way is right view, samadhi, right motivation, samma sankappa, right speech, samma vajja, right action, samma kamanta, right livelihood, samma ajivo, right effort, samma vajjama, right awareness or mindfulness, samma sati, and right concentration, samma samadhi, culminating for the arahat in right release and right knowledge and vision of release. That's the way. That's the way. Thank you for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. Living here in Denmark is very expensive, so you're welcome to contribute this Dhamma sharing that reach out to something like 100,000 every day, and is pumping out both from SoundCloud, which you can find on whatbuddhasaid.net, the website, and also on YouTube and various other channels. So thank you for your contribution. Thereby also thanks to all Dayakas, all supporters, especially those who support every month, the regular donors, because there's a pattern of a small band of people who have supported this Dhamma sharing for a number of years, and thereby also paid this camera and paid this computer and so on. So thank you for that. Thank you for that. Without that support from the laity to the monastic sangha, then the Dhamma could not thrive. So it's a symbiotic relationship between the monastic sangha, the monks and the nuns, that gains freedom to seek the Dhamma and thereby also promote it, conserve it, preserve it. And then the lay people that gains the merit, the pin, and thereby the future, the karma, the good karma, the karmic elevation, by sharing their material gains, which they have earned in their own, the sweat of their own brow, in a righteous way. So thank you for that. And may you indeed have a nice and noble day. Namo tasso bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Indeed, indeed. Thank you for today, and may you have a nice and noble day. While being here in Denmark, you can see it's spring. When I came here, it was fairly cold, 3 degrees Celsius, and there has been snow this winter also. A thought came to my mind. that it has been a long-standing wish for me to bring the Dhamma, early Buddhism, back here to Denmark, who gave me a free education in as a medical doctor. There's both a need for people who is fairly stressed, and there's also an interest in Buddhism in general and in Eastern philosophy and yoga in particular. However, there's almost no knowledge whatsoever about what the historical Buddha Gautama actually said 2,500 years ago. And the reason for that is so there is three monasteries here in Denmark, and also the same situation goes for all of Europe actually. There's very, very few monasteries and very, very few monks there to propagate the Dhamma, to share the Dhamma to the local residents. And those that are, all these three that are in Denmark, they are of Asian origin. This means that it's usually Thai, the Thai communities that has a monastery, small monastery, with some monks. But these monks are Thai monks, they speak only Thai language. So they can not easily communicate with the Danish people. Can't do in English, but this severely hampers the effort to get the Dhamma out into society. There's fairly limited Dhamma sharing from the monasteries here, the three monasteries in the entire Denmark, 5 million population. And the same goes for all of Europe, actually. So if one should seriously get the Dhamma to root in the Western world, then there's a need for Western monks who speak the local language as their mother tongue to stay there over a prolonged period and to share Dhamma with the local people. Then will trickle out in society, little by little, through newspapers, television, and so on, internet, meditation courses, Buddhist coaching, regular Dhamma meetings, and various other Dhamma activities. This can only be done if one lives as a local monk, speaking the local language in the community that is supposed to be benefiting from the Dhamma. So, in this regard, I had an idea about either it could be a small hermitage, like the one you see here, a small building in the forest, a forest hermitage here in Denmark, or it could be a forest monastery for two or three monks, or it could be a full-fledged meditation center. As you see, there's a building here that 2 years ago was shown to me to be allocated to this purpose, but which need a roof, a major project. So what I'm suggesting is kind of like a Dhamma project called Seeding the Dhamma in Denmark. And if anybody is seriously interested in assisting this project grow, so the Dhamma is seeded first in Denmark and then maybe in Scandinavia, and then spread out little by little, trickling out to Europe, I would be very helpful, very gratitude, and very thankful for any assistance you can provide. However, it is not impossible to get these places. The woodpecker is talking it with here. The woodpecker agrees. Certainly so. Nevertheless, if anybody is interested in this Seeding the Dhamma in Denmark project, in assisting this on the long term, starting with making a Buddhist hermitage like this, with a small kitchen and a small bathroom, and isolation and heating, then please contact me on my email, bhantesamahita@gmail.com, bhant.samahita@gmail.com, regarding this Seeding the Dhamma in Denmark project. Thank you for your attention. May many beings become thus happy thereby. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato
Sammasambuddhassa, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha, indeed. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. As the next Buddha, the noble Arya Ajitamateya, will say, you can come as you like, but you pay as you go. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.